All right, the stand that we're looking at here across the creek, we thought's more indicative of what, you know, most folks have with regard to a mature mixed hardwood stand. And Matt and I went through and we marked the trees that we would treat, and we put a horizontal line on those that we would girdle and spray. We put a vertical line on those that we would likely hinge cut or cut down, and put an X on those that we would cut down or fail and allow the sprouts to come up for the browse. And the effect that we were hoping for is to walk down, because everybody that's wanting to do this, they'll say, well, who can I get to mark my woods? Don't be offended, but you, you. Here's the difference. Probably most of you don't know your trees, but with just a little field guide, you can learn what trees you have. And probably you don't have but 10 or 15 trees that represent the lion's share of the trees in your woods. So surely y'all can learn 10 or 15 species of trees. Then you have the joy and the fulfillment of walking through your woods and you making the decisions on which way the stand goes, which trees are kept, and which trees go out. And then you can work on that at your leisure when you have time to do it, instead of trying to fit somebody else in and paying them a lot of money to come in and then mark and then come in and cut, etc. So just with a chainsaw and a squirt bottle, and you don't have to mark the trees, of course, once you learn them, and you're doing this by sight. And one of the key things is to look up, not look down. So if we're standing right here, and we see the yellow poplar right back there, and a sweet gum behind it, and a northern red oak right here, look at the crowns of those trees. Now look at the northern red oak right back there and the crown of that one. Now look at the crown of that yellow poplar right there in between. See how small it is? And so when you start looking at the crowns of the desirable trees and how they're distributed, quickly you see, man, I can take out a majority of these trees and will need to in order to get the effect that I'm looking for. So look across through here at all those trees that are marked. Obviously, most of them, if we were doing this for deer, and that's exactly what I would do right here, most of these trees would be killed or cut down. Even amongst the oaks, because, as Matt mentioned in one of his slides, that 40% of the trees, he didn't say this, but this is what he should have said, but 40% of the trees produce 75% of the acorns. So do you know what that means? And this is math, it's not an opinion, this is a fact. You can go into a stand that is solid oaks and kill or cut down 50% of the individuals, if you know which ones are the good producers, cut down 50% of them and increase your acorn production. Because then the crowns of the ones that you leave are going to get larger. And with a lot, you know, if a tree has a crown this shape, it can produce how many acorns? This many. If it has a crown that looks like this, then it can produce that much more. So simply by giving the crown more room to grow, and we have measured on average, and this is pretty wild. I found it hard to believe. A 25% increase in crown size only one growing season after release. So it responds fast. And so if you just thin a very few trees, and let's say, for example, you opened up where you get like 20% sunlight into the stand, those crowns are going to respond so quickly, you're going to have to go back in and thin some more pretty fast, because they're going to fill back in and you're going to be back to closed canopy conditions. So look to at least thin and allow at least 30% sunlight at a bare minimum 20, but I like to shoot for a minimum of 30% sunlight to come in and get that response. Now, take a look at all of the stems that are marked. I didn't count them, but I would say probably would you say 80% of them are marked over there? You know, and we didn't go way up in the hill, but you know, back about 40 yards or so. All right, that does not mean you're gonna get 80% sunlight, not at all. For example, if you look at that yellow poplar right there, if we cut down that tree, it's not gonna do anything with regard to sunlight. We haven't increased sunlight at all. So a lot of those stems, their crowns are stacked such that you're gonna have to cut a lot more in order to get the amount of sunlight that you're looking for. If all of those trees are cut or killed that I have marked, I would estimate that we're gonna allow about 50% sunlight into that area. So don't be afraid to cut or kill a few trees. Think more about what's growing on the ground and the structure of that vegetation. That's what's number one, holding deer, and number two, feeding deer. And look at the oaks and the beeches and whatnot as a periodic bonus.
What age do beech trees produce?
In forested situations, not growing out in the open, usually you're looking at around year 30 to 40. So I don't know how old this tree is. I would guess that tree is probably 120 years old, but it's not producing beech nuts every year. It's very sporadic. But I mean, I have a heart. I don't want to kill every great big tree, you know. But all kidding aside, there's a lot to say about aesthetics. And when you walk in your woods, I mean, you know, it might kind of sound ridiculous, but you want to feel good. And when you walk in your woods and you have chosen the trees to keep and the trees to keep out, that does make you feel, I don't know why I put my hand in my heart, but it makes you feel good. You know, you've had a hand in steering this and providing it. And that's fulfillment. We're not just shooting and managing deer. We're also managing the land that supports the deer. And don't look at learning a few trees as an insurmountable task. It's pretty doggone easy. Now, you know, I guarantee you, of all of the careers that I'm looking at here and all of the jobs, your jobs are a whole lot more difficult than learning a few tree species. You know, foresters and wildlifers, we got it pretty easy, you know, just learning stuff like this, right? But it's not difficult. Just because you don't know it now doesn't mean that it's difficult to do. Just get a plant ID guide and figure it out.
Greg, in combination, you've got a lot of timber value. You've marked there. If you do it in combination with a timber harvest, you can really get some economic benefit. At the same time, you can improve your hood.
Absolutely, and I included that on the handout. If your trees that you are taking out have enough value to have a logger look at it and place a bid on it, then that's just gravy. Two things that often come up. Number one is the trees that you're trying to take out won't pay their way out of the woods, because most often you're leaving the best quality trees and you're taking out more of low quality stems and species. Two, and this is a very real thing, it gets back to the previous point about aesthetics. Logging always causes a scar. And a lot of people don't like to see that. And so if you don't want to see the scar, which, I mean, it heals over time, but if you don't want to see the scar of skitter trails and, you know, areas where the soil is severely impacted and brought up and scooted over, and then a lot of times, unless you have a logger that's very conscientious and trying to help you with your objectives, a lot of times with those leave trees, they'll be dragging other trees out and scar up the bottom of those, so that then has degraded that tree, and a lot of times those die. So those are all things in the decision-making process. But certainly on various sites, we certainly have loggers to come in and get as much value out of the trees that we can if they'll produce it. But a lot of landowners, they don't want to do that. They'd rather just go in and kill those species and individuals that they don't want and let it just respond naturally.